Hi, and thank you for joining me for another video. And friends, this week we have a double parsha, and they are Tetzriah and Metzora. Now, I have to tell you that these portions of the Torah are not the most exciting ones, and that's why many, when they come across these series of parshiot, typically skip them. Why? Because we feel that because the facts in these chapters are no longer physically relevant in our society, what's the use in trying to understand them or applying them to our lives? Well, friends, today I'm going to try to show you on how all these rituals are just placed here to help us guard the ethical. In other words, embedded within all these practices, in their core lie the building blocks of an ethical society. How? By placing a huge separation of ultimate acknowledgement between everything dealing with death or what causes death and everything that encourages life, to the point that the parsha begins with the law regarding a woman who gives birth and what she should do after her run-in with death. Because, friends, it's no secret that childbirth was one of the leading killers of expected mothers of that time, which is why the Almighty does not allow this opportunity to just pass her by, but demands her purification after the whole ordeal of childbirth. Why? Because just as light shines the brightest in a dark room, or how we begin to appreciate what we have when we almost lose it all, she will learn to appreciate life better by performing a ritual that will create a mental landmark, always reminding her of the whole ordeal. And also, there's another opinion brought down by the Mefarshim that her korban was actually brought because of what she may have said or thought negatively during her time in labor. And friends, we see that the parsha builds from here, how the first parak regards an encounter with death. The second parak of the parsha speaks about the separation of potential death and how we should treat someone who has a potentially lethal skin ailment. And what does it say? It says that we should put him outside of the camp lest he infect others. And friends, in this example, even though the individual had no run-in with death, the message being brought to us is even more important. Here, friends, the Torah is laying down one of the most important principles in this whole Sefer. And what's that? That the community matters, and that the majority should not suffer for the minority. And how those in the minority should understand this. How the first example focused on the micro, on the personal, and this example focuses on the macro, on the community as a whole, which the Torah considers more important, which is actually the opposite of what goes on in the Jewish world today, on how we kowtow to the individuals who get offended instead of asking what's good for the community as a whole, or how we have rabbis too scared to properly lead their people out of fear that someone might get offended. And friends, I don't have to tell you that especially in the Jewish world today, there's always someone to get offended. But friends, we see that the Torah does not stop there, and it actually goes up in the scale to the point that the parsha then goes on to mention the consequences of even having a dirty house, basically telling us that we should keep our houses clean, telling us that even our habitations can incur impurity, introducing us to the notion that we have an obligation to keep our environment clean. In my opinion, solidifying the standards for a proper Jewish community with 1, the individual, 2, the people as a whole, and 3, the environment that we live in. And these 3 in this order of importance are the pillar of a civilized society. And friends, another important idea that this parsha brings down is that it mentions that religious leaders of the time, in this case the priests, are the ones who decide whether certain individuals are fit to remain in the community or not, or even if their houses are to be demolished or not, which actually goes against the silly notion understood nowadays that one is only accountable to God for his or her actions, or the silly cliche that only God can judge me, which actually takes us to yet another interesting area, that if this was done because of physical contamination, my friends, how much more would we assume that this would also be the practice for ideological contamination? And the reason I feel I need to touch on this area also is because virtually all of Israel's problems today stem from not separating the religiously unclean from Klal Yisrael, whose sickness, I don't have to tell you, my friends, it's even more contagious than any physical ailment. Whether it's communism, liberalism, feminism, Judaism or even Zionism, because religious Jews have done nothing to separate the members of these movements from the camp of Israel, our families have paid the price. And as this parsha states that an infected garment must be burned, so does the Torah state that we have an obligation to burn the evil from amongst our midst. If you're interested, my friends, in learning more about Torah Judaism, please visit bejewish.org. And if you're interested in converting to Judaism, which I encourage for you to do, please visit Torah Judaism International at torahjudaism.org. Thank you.